I got no excuses.
Welcome to the Way Out Recovery Hour. I'm Bob Sharitz, and a couple of happies. Happy Monday to everyone. Happy holidays as we roll into this Thanksgiving week. I don't think I'm the only one. I heard someone share about it at a meeting that I was at recently, about the resentment that they had that we go straight from Halloween to Christmas.
Yeah.
Right? And my favorite holiday is Thanksgiving. You know, I don't know. Like, Thanksgiving got the short end of the stick or something, man, because those other two are dress up and flash up decorate up. And
my house goes straight from Easter to Christmas.
See what I'm saying?
See
what's happening? And so anyway, happy Thanksgiving. You know, every Monday I like to remind people, that we have this beautiful week sitting in front of us with all the wonderful people in our lives. God, I want to cry as I'm saying that, man, just because I'm so, there's a lot of special people in my life. And so I remind everyone of that every week, that's oftentimes we sit on a Monday and we look at the week and we think, oh my God, how big is this week and how much stuff I have to do and look at my checklist and all the appointments and right? And it doesn't have to be that way. If we can get ourselves in a spot where we can get quiet, we can really reflect upon all the things that we have to be grateful for. And we can sit on a Monday and really think about what a beautiful week this is in front of us. And so, that's the weekly message that I like to put out there to try to get everybody to stop everything they're doing, the hustle and the bustle, just for a minute, put your face up to the sun, or if it's a cloudy day, just sit outside and feel that breeze, maybe the rain on your face, and take a breath. And just take a breath, And this week, we have that extra, right? We have the extra of, being together with people that we love and remembering what these holidays can be about if we choose them to be about the Thanksgiving, right? Mm-hmm. The gratitude and the love we have for this life that we've been given and how blessed and grateful we are despite all the stuff.
Yeah.
That can sometimes happen around us. Our town is in a is in a sad time, but also in a reflective time. Every conversation that I've had in the last week and a half, like probably everybody out here in some part of that conversation, comes up the topic of what happened the Thursday before last, right? Of a shooting at our school and how much that sucks.
Yeah.
Right? That we live in this world where kids are killing kids. It's not cool. But despite all of that stuff, we are overwhelmed, or we can be overwhelmed, by all the beautiful stuff that's around us. Look at how our community has come together.
Mm-hmm.
Look at how we stand for each other. Look at how we talk to each other. There's a lot of work to be done if we don't want this to happen anymore.
Yeah.
And my personal opinion is that we need to start very young, teaching our kids emotional regulation, communication skills, meditation, and how to really take care of themselves emotionally. And if we start to do that now, this stuff goes away, right? So welcome to the show. This is the Way Out Recovery Hour. We are the way out. I have Melissa Flowers in with me today. We also have Michelle Field over there, and we also have Brenda Way. And there are some people behind the scenes that aren't in the clinical piece of it, in the counseling piece of it, in the therapeutic piece of it. That give us support and are wonderful for our company. We are today, just like we promised, right, Melissa?
Right.
About 3 weeks ago, to do a part two on that
relapse.
How to stay sober, right?
Yeah.
Like how to stay sober, how to be okay, how to not get yourself in a spot where relapse is part of your story, because it doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to be. So, and over at The Way Out, we are an intensive outpatient program. If you haven't come by our office, come on by. We're located on the corner of Plum and Bokeh Canyon, 28118 Bokeh Canyon Road, on the in the same shopping center as La Casina,
Vincenzo's
7-Eleven, on the same side as the 7-Eleven. Oh, and by the way, I'm going to give a little plug for that Indian restaurant that's right next door to us is suddenly the bomb. I don't know how it was before. It was
I don't even know what it's called.
But I think it's called King Halal.
Okay.
Right? Mm-hmm. So it's Indian food that's right next door. We're right next door to the Indian place. And while you're over there, have lunch there because it really, really is good. I'm impressed with their food, and it takes a lot to impress me with restaurant food, and I'm really impressed with them. And come on by if you haven't visited our site. We love to have visitors over there. Drop on in and chat with us about how you're doing or how your loved ones are doing. If we can help in any way, we would be happy to help in any way. Give us a call at 661-296-4444. That's 296-4444. Or you can go to our website, thewayoutrecoverysCV.com, and you can submit for a free confidential assessment on there. You can submit a message, and we will get back to you as soon as we possibly can. We are here to help, and we want to provide, help for substance abuse and mental health issues, but we are primary substance abuse in the community that we love so much. So, come on over and visit us. Drop us a line. If you or a loved one is suffering with drug and alcohol issues or mental health issues, you don't have to anymore. There is help. There is hope. There is recovery. That's what we do. We like to try to help people, pull out of this stuff and be okay, And so come on by and visit us. Like I said, I got Melissa Flowers in studio with me today. We're going to talk about relapse prevention. But I think first, come on back after this break. I think we're going to start it off by talking about what our key components are to living a life that accentuates our recovery, that keeps us clean and not only clean and sober, but keeps us really grateful and feeling good about living life. So yep. I'm Bob Sheritz. This is the Way Out Recovery Hour. We'll be back in a minute.
If you find yourself in an issue with the IRS and they're threatening you or you can't sleep at night, remember this name, Anthem Tax Services. Within 2 months, they saved me $25,000.
If you are a small business owner or self-employed and owe $10,000 or more to the IRS or state, call Anthem Tax Services today. 866-630-2694. We have saved millions of dollars in tax debt, and our goal is to reduce your tax debt to as little as possible. Call 866-630-2694. We are confident enough in our services to offer a 100% money-back guarantee if we can't put you in a better position than where you started. Call for a free consultation, and we'll also take care of your tax case study for free, saving you hundreds of dollars. Call 866-630-2694. Anthem Tax Services, the trusted name in tax resolution. 866-630-2694. 866-630-2694.
The Art Gallery of Santa Clarita Artists Association, located in downtown Newhall on 6th Street between Railroad and Main, features local members' original artwork with changing exhibits every 2 months. Purchase affordable art for your home or as gifts. Open Friday through Sunday or by appointment. Artists wishing to join the SCAA can visit santaclaritaartists.org, come to our free monthly meetings at Barnes & Noble, or stop by the gallery. For upcoming shows, check us out at santaclaritaartists.org. We make visual art visible.
It's time to plan our company party. Tables, chairs, lights, and a dance floor. So much to coordinate.
AV Party Rentals has everything you need for your company party. Visit their large and beautiful showroom in Newhall and discover how AV Party Rentals can create that extra accent for your company party. No worrying, no stress during setup, because their delivery staff is friendly, efficient, and willing to go that extra step to make things easier. On Newhall Avenue and Carl Court, or plan your party online at avparty.com.
This holiday music is brought to you by Providence Holy Cross Medical Center, your community health partner. To learn more about our award-winning care, call 1-888-HEALING or visit us on the web at providence.org.
Your hometown station.
The only station I listen to while I'm on the 14 heading to work in the morning.
98.1 FM and AM 1220.
I got no excuse. Welcome back to the Way Out Recovery Hour. I'm Bob Sharitz. And you know what's interesting is, so I don't know if, I think so, when we're doing so we do Facebook Live. A couple of things, you know, if you're listening to us right now, you're on either AM 1220 or you're on 98.1, FM 98.1, AM 1220, or you're watching the Facebook Live on KCS Radio Facebook page or the Way Out Recovery SCV Facebook page. Right. You can also, I don't know if everybody knows about this, but KCS has a free app that you can download and it'll stream, you know, just turn it on and it'll play whatever's playing. And that's free. So download that as well. But there are multiple places. But what's cool on the Facebook thing, it doesn't stop during commercials, right? Like right. The radio, right? It goes to commercial, they play whatever they're playing. But the Facebook thing is still going. And the in between the sometimes
the conversations.
Sometimes in between the radio spots, like we get into these conversations, right? And so I can imagine what people are thinking when they're watching, but they can't hear what we're saying because right. I'm all over the place. You know, I'm pretty animated in my stuff. I can't sit – look at – I'm going to look right at the camera. I can't sit still anyway, right?
Right.
Like you've noticed. And if I – sometimes I'll watch these videos and I'm like this, man. I'm like all over the place with my stuff. I can't imagine what people are – wondering what we're talking about in between. So what we're talking about is emotional well-being, and what we're talking about is being okay. You know, I think on some level, and this is, I'm going to say it anyway, even though it might sound a little bit foreign to people who have not suffered with or struggled from substance use disorders or mental health. But I think in some ways we are blessed to have the disease of addiction.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And the reason I say that is because, you know, when we come into recovery, there's this thing, like our very lives depend upon us doing the program.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for a lot of people, it really is do or die. Like,
right.
You have this choice, right? And so, and the program consists of taking care of ourselves physically, mentally, emotionally, mm-hmm. and spiritually,
right.
and working on relationships. And the program, the successful recovery program, also consists of me doing my best not to be so darn selfish all the time and to think of you,
right?
Right? So whatever I'm doing in my life, how is that going to affect the people that are around me before I just impulsively
right.
do stuff, right? And so because our very lives depend on it, we go, okay, I'm willing to do whatever.
Yeah.
And we do it, and then we start to find out that living that kind of life has benefits that are just tremendous.
Yeah. Like the term grateful alcoholic.
Right.
When I heard that, I was like, really?
Like, wow.
Grateful. But now I'm like, I couldn't be more grateful.
Right.
Not only the community I've built, but the relationships it's impacted and changed in my own life. You know, I think everybody could benefit from a program.
Well, yeah, so emotional well-being is what was the discussion in between the right on the break, and
mm-hmm.
but it's really we are sort of blessed in a way to have this disease so that we're forced to do that,
to live that kind of life.
Because we get this perspective that goes, if everybody did that, then things would be different.
Right.
Right? And so when we talk about successful recovery, the goal, and I've said this probably 1,000 times, right? There's one goal. What's the one goal? To not use,
to not
right?
drink or
to
use,
like
yeah.
not get loaded.
Yeah.
So there's only one goal.
Right.
When you're in drug and alcohol recovery, one goal. And sometimes you're going to have really bad days.
Yeah.
And you know, where it takes everything in you
to
achieve that one
yeah.
goal, right? But what you quickly find out is that there's so much more to recovery.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to say that we have one goal, and that's to not get high, right?
Well, that's the ultimate goal.
Well, yeah. It's hard to hear that if you're standing outside the recovery process going, oh, like that's what it's about, just not getting high.
Right.
Like, what do people, when people are new, mm-hmm. and you tell them, look, total abstinence is really the answer, what kind of reaction do you get?
I get a lot of different reactions. I actually just had this conversation in a group the other day, and all the different personalities have different perspectives. Some people understand that, and some people are working towards that, but majority of people I get, oh, especially the younger people, oh, really, nothing? I can't, you know, do a little bit of this or eventually control my drinking, or, you know, it's like so foreign to anybody that abstinence is the ultimate goal. There are some, though, however, yeah. that are all on board with it, but they can't imagine that anything could be fun or that life could be, quality of life is improved by not picking up a drink or a drug. So it's kind of interesting.
Now, let me clarify for our listeners that, you know, our treatment center is different, I think, than most or maybe all. I don't know about all, but
most, yeah.
Different than most, because most, not in that they don't all have the same goal. The same goal is for you to maintain it, to get and stay sober.
Yeah.
And then work on your life in the arena of sobriety, of sober, right? But we don't demand, when you come to our treatment center, we don't say you have to stop doing everything or you can't come here. Or you can't come here.
Which is, I think, what makes it welcoming for people who are unsure to come and stay, because other treatment centers have told them 100% abstinence
or you're going to have to go to a
residential or detox or some outlandish thing they're not ready to do. When they come into ours, of course we request abstinence, and of course we encourage abstinence, and we create areas in our treatment where you have to be abstinent to participate.
Right.
But they might be struggling a little bit and they don't feel ashamed to come back and say that.
Well, and let me, don't get it wrong, we don't let people show up to our groups loaded.
Under the influence. Yeah, yeah. You know? That's what I was trying to say.
Yeah, we don't let that happen.
Yeah, if you're participating.
You have to be not under the influence now.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, so when they, one of the things we set down is obviously the ultimate goal is abstinence. But if someone's struggling, they have to attend the program, not under the influence that day. Come to our community support activities, not under the influence. But if someone is struggling, we try to meet them where they're at.
Well, back to the question that I asked you, like, what are some of the reactions? And the reason that we do that is because if we came in and said, so the message is this, is that your best chance of long-term successful recovery and a new life is for you to not do anything.
Right.
And our experience is that if you do something, more than likely, now it's not 100%, right? But more than likely that if you're still over here smoking pot, that the pot's going to become the new problem, or it's going to lead you back to the old problem,
yeah.
Right? And we've seen that happen over and over and over and over and over mm-hmm. again. But if we just came in and said, no, that's the rule, and you can't do it, then a lot of people would walk away.
Or not come back.
What we say is, mm-hmm. that's the goal, and we want you there because we want you to have successful recovery.
Right.
But what do you think about that? And what they'll say is like stuff like, oh my God, how am I ever going to have fun?
Yeah, that's the biggest one. Like, how am I ever going to barbecue again without a beer?
Right.
You know?
How can I go to a wedding, maybe me, even my own wedding, without having a toast with champagne?
Right.
How do I do that?
Yeah, how do I go to a concert, you know? I mean, like, just things
How do I not smoke weed at a concert?
Yeah, a lot of things that people envision that's the fun aspect of it. If, you know, if you take the drug away, it can't be fun. And so it's kind of interesting to hear people's perspective, because I had that same perspective.
Right.
So I can identify with that and say, yeah, I really didn't think I'd do any of those things again, and now I can do all of those things and remember it.
Well, and truthfully, that was my experience. When
right.
I first got clean, that was my experience. Is like, there was nothing to do.
There was nothing, yeah.
Because that's all I did.
Right.
And when somebody says to me, how am I going to go to a concert and not get high? Right.
Mm-hmm.
What I will say back to them is, wouldn't it be interesting for you to evaluate how many activities in your life directly involve drugs and alcohol?
Right. Let's
Everything. Take a look at that. Let's step back and take a look at that. If you're telling me that you can't do anything unless you're getting high with somebody because right. that's the main focus of your social right. activity, you might want to take a look at that.
Yeah.
Because if my life revolves around drinking, doesn't mean I'm an alcoholic, right? Yeah. Doesn't I may not even be having problems as a result of my drinking.
Right.
But if my life revolves around a social life of drinking,
right.
then alcohol is really important to me.
Really important right? to me. And I think alcohol is one of the I think I said this the last time we were on.
Well, you could put anything
but,
in there.
But as you say that, it reminds me that alcohol is the one that people justify the most.
Well, sure, because we can do it in public. We can do yeah. it in public with other people,
yeah,
right?
And the idea of giving up the illegal substance right. of substances right. makes sense. Well, yeah, I need to do that. It was illegal. But you mean I can't have a beer after I do that? And so identifying that, like, drugs and alcohol are the same thing yeah. is the hardest thing that I deal with as far as relapse.
Well, because of social acceptance, right? Yeah. Because, like, a crack-smoking party is a party of one,
right?
You know? Right, it's not right. like everyone's not out. Woo, yeah. having a right because because it's a different kind
well,
of drug.
And that's the thing. Like recently, I've been seeing that with the relapses is that people that are doing like opiates and you know cocaine and stimulants and they want to be able to drink or smoke pot.
Yeah.
And so that's where the relapses is they're occurring because they're like, well, I'm not you know doing heroin anymore. I'm just smoking to calm down and identifying that that's. An issue as well has been a little bit more difficult, but
so I've stopped doing all the other drugs and now I'm like being anxious. I'm really anxious
uh-huh.
and
yeah.
so I'm going but I so the weed's helping me.
Well, they think it's helping them
right.
right. They think it's helping them until
so what do we do with that? And when someone has that, what do we do with that?
Well, one, I try to help them implement other healthy coping yeah. skills. Yeah. But two, they're anxious because now they're smoking marijuana. And
well,
so like,
and
when they're
it, yeah,
coming
yeah.
off the marijuana, their body's starting to get anxious and they don't identify that it's because they're coming off of it.
Well, and weed's an interesting thing. So pot is an interesting thing, too, is there are severe withdrawal symptoms. From especially from today's the potency of today's marijuana
yeah.
and the strains and the
yep.
different you know the different levels of THC and the other chemicals in it, you know, it's almost not even if anyone ever tells you, well, it's natural, right?
Not anymore.
In today's world, it's not really, right?
It's synthetic.
Like, it's like grown in liquid
yeah.
in a closet somewhere with chemicals, right? And so it's not like it used to be. Sometimes it is, but they're enhanced or whatever.
Yeah.
But nevertheless. It's an interesting thing when it comes to withdrawal is because marijuana doesn't come out of your system right away.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like other drugs where you're feeling like with alcohol. If I drink severe alcohol, within hours of stopping
yeah.
drinking, I may start to shake or
yeah.
feel withdrawal symptoms. With marijuana, it can take a couple of weeks,
which makes it hard to identify that that's what it is.
And so people will go, oh, I haven't smoked in 3 or 4 days and I feel great.
Right.
I tell them, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Just
wait a minute.
Hang tight, right?
Mm-hmm.
When all of a sudden you're irritable and you're treating everybody bad and you're on edge and you have anxiety and you can't sleep and you can't eat, right?
That's what I tell our people.
And they go, well, see, I have to have it because I'm anxious.
Yeah. Yeah. And so then it goes back to the cycle of...
Right, the cycle.
Yeah.
Well, and it's the same thing, you know, interestingly, we say that sort of in general terms, right, is healthy coping skills. Like, okay, if you're using this to combat your anxiety,
mm-hmm.
but using this is going to cause more problems than benefit that you're getting
right.
from it, then what are you going to do to combat your anxiety that isn't this?
Right. So some of the, like, we just actually did relapse prevention last week, and we were kind of identifying what works for us to give suggestions to the other people.
You mean as coping skills?
As coping
okay.
skills, yeah. And so... We sat down and we talked about, like, what works for me. I might go for a walk. If I'm anxious and I'm sitting still and I'm sitting on my hands and I'm racing thoughts and I don't know what's going to happen, maybe I go for a walk.
Yeah.
And if I take a
walk.
Well,
go for a walk. It works for everybody.
Yeah.
If you can get yourself up to do it, right?
If you get yourself up to do
yeah.
it. A lot of times if I'm anxious and I still get anxious just because I'm not using doesn't mean that goes away, I might call somebody. If I say it out loud, it takes the power away for me.
Right.
You know, I call somebody and I say, hey, this is what I'm struggling with. And then I find that, like, I feel better. Or I go to an AA meeting, maybe share. There's a lot of things you can do. Healthy diet and sleep, that, like...
Oh, it makes a world of difference.
I mean, obviously you can't, in the moment you're anxious, go to sleep. But if you've been getting proper sleep and eating healthy... That will decrease on its own naturally. But there are a lot of different things that we can do.
So let me talk to you about. So since we're in a part two.
Part two.
And here's a recap on part one, right? As we talked about the physical things that you can do to steer away from possibly relapsing. Hanging out with people that are getting loaded, hanging out in environments where people are drinking or getting high, holding on to your old paraphernalia, glorifying the drug use, and having those kind of conversations, all the different things that you can do, changing the phone numbers in your phone, you know, not contacting
those
people, blocking, having conversations.
I think that's Snapchat, right?
I think that's one of the most important things you can do is not say to the people that are hitting you up, you know, catch me later.
Right.
But to say to them very definitively, I am not doing that anymore.
Yeah.
Miss me with that stuff. Right? Miss me with that stuff. Because I'm not doing that anymore.
Yeah.
I'm not living in that world anymore.
Right.
And so don't hit me up. So, you know, we got into that conversation the last time you and I were here talking about relapse prevention.
Yeah.
And so you have physical, you have mental. Mm-hmm. Right? The mental part of relapse is that little voice that starts to tell you the lie about drug use, right? Because the truth is, and I caught myself doing this when I was newly sober, right? As I was still smoking cigarettes. And so I'd be out on the smoke area at my treatment center or my AA meetings or whatever. And I'm out there smoking, and I would be, and we would be having that remember when conversation.
Right.
Oh, you remember when we were over and doing that?
Yeah,
and,
romanticizing it,
making it feel like it's good. And I had to stop. I caught myself one day doing that, and I said, "Whoa, here's the truth, right?"
Yep.
So here's an example. I was at a concert with about 4 years sober, and I went with a bunch of sober people, and it was. I know you're not going to believe this, but it was like the Grateful Dead-ish kind of Phil Lesh and friends, right? So we're in Santa Barbara. I'm in a safe environment. I'm in a safe group. I got probably 10 people that went with us.
Yeah.
All sober people. And I'm in that show and the music's playing and my head started to do that thing. So there was this cute girl in front of me dancing and she had a beer in her hand. And somebody passed her some weed, and she passed it on to the next, and I was watching all that, and I smelled the beer, and I could smell the weed, and my head started the story. God, remember how much fun you used to have?
Oh, that's
so here's the mental part of it, right, is my head started talking to me. Now, I'm sitting next to my AA sponsor.
Yeah.
He's in the seat next to me, and my buddies are all around me, man, and we came together, and we're talking program and everything, and my head starts to talk to me. And it starts to do what I used to do on the smoke breaks. It starts to remember when.
Mm-hmm.
God, remember how much fun you used to have? You know? You could, if you had a beer, you could talk to this girl. Maybe even get a date. You know? Whatever, right? And then I had to stop myself. Because the truth is that I have to combat that with the truth. The truth about my drinking and my drug use is this. Is I would have got a beer or two in me. And I would have smoked some of that weed. And I would have got some other stuff in me, and I would have been fighting with that girl's boyfriend, and I would have been loud mouthing, and the cops would have been dragging me out of that concert.
Right.
Because that's what happens to me when I drink, right? The alcohol takes over and I'm an idiot.
Right.
And so that's the mental part of relapse. That's one of the things is the glorification.
Right. Yeah. And the mental part of it, the main part of it is that there's this part of you that's thinking about getting high and this part of you that's not. So it's a constant battle, you know. Is it as bad as I think it is? And that's one of the things we discuss in the relapse part of it, because you kind of don't know what's happening. And
if you mean you're not aware of that necessarily.
You're not consciously aware of it right away. There is a point in time where you will become consciously aware of it. You'll start minimizing your consequences. Right. You know, it wasn't that bad. And that's one of the biggest ones, is that convincing yourself that it wasn't that bad. Kind of what you just said. Man, I did have some good times.
Now, because it doesn't happen every time I drink or use drugs, I don't go to jail.
Right.
And I don't fight with people. And I don't get in trouble.
Not every time.
But somebody said, so I heard that one time. And then I heard somebody else say, okay, maybe that's the truth, but let me ask you a question. Every time you got in trouble or went to jail,
were you loaded?
Were you under the influence? Yeah. And I said, oh, yes, I was,
right? Yeah.
So maybe every time I drink, I don't get in trouble, but every time I get in trouble, I've been drinking.
Right.
Right?
And I don't get in trouble when I'm sober. I just don't.
You don't? Maybe I can work on that.
Yeah, you can help me. Guide
Stay
me.
Tuned. We're going to come back after this break, and we'll talk more about successful program of recovery and combating relapse. Melissa Flowers is in studio with me. I'm Bob Sharitz. This is the Way Out Recovery Hour. We'll be back in a minute.
Healthcare can be difficult if you're underinsured or have Medi-Cal. Samuel Dixon Family Health Center can help. Services are available on a sliding fee schedule. The mission of the Samuel Dixon Family Health Center is to give the Santa Clarita Valley access to affordable, quality primary care. There are three locations to serve you: Canyon Country, Newhall, and Valverde. Go to sdfhc.org for more information and to find the location most convenient for you.
Time for a car wash, but fearful of the scratches that go along with it? Canyon Car Wash and Valencia Car Wash proudly use 100% lamb's cloth to prevent scratches and provide the best wash possible. Both locations use environmentally friendly solutions to wash and wax your vehicle, and they both accept all other car wash coupons. Give your vehicle the wash it deserves. Visit Canyon Car Wash on Soledad across from Edwards Cinema, or Valencia Car Wash on Creekside Road behind Target.
Mission Valley Bank puts the community in community banking. They strive to be your most trusted bank. Mission Valley Bank is happy to sponsor KHTS Holiday Music. Happy holidays.
Your hometown station, KHTS.
I got no excuses. Welcome back to the Way Out Recovery Hour. It's Christmas time. It's coming up on Christmas time. And there are these really cool little candy canes hanging around everywhere out here on the tree and in buckets at KHTS. And so I was chewing on one right now when when we came back on. So if you are just joining us, you know, Melissa and I have been in this conversation about, you know, how to stay clean and sober and what happens in the recovery process that can potentially drive us back to using again. And I was telling a story about being at a concert and how my head started talking to me. And I got to tell you, because it's awesome, Melissa told me a story during the break about her experience at the Bone Thugs and Harmony show, right?
places right. You think you couldn't go sober.
Well, but we do, right? And we make it through those experiences.
And I stayed sober, by the way.
We make it through
End
those experiences.
End of that story. I stay sober.
Well, and so did I because I had to. So what we do in recovery is we learn to combat that stinking thinking, right? That thing, those thought processes that try to do a couple of things. And so I'm going to throw some terms out here, and you can help me explain this, right? Awfulizing sobriety.
Just the idea
that's a made-up term, by the way, awfulizing.
It's a group I do.
Well, it's funny.
Awfulizing abstinence.
Somebody put that in a book, awfulizing, right? And I think Terrence Gorski or something,
the
father of relapse
prevention.
What's
funny about that is I was doing a group one time, and I was like, okay, you know, romanticizing. But then I was like, awfulizing abstinence. Someone spelled awfulizing.
That
someone
is not a word.
Awfulizing. I'm sorry. That
so
is
what
not
is awfulizing? Awfulizing
well, it's
sobriety.
The idea that you can't, well, one, what we talked about, you can't have fun. It's everything negative about sobriety. You can't see anything positive as an outcome of it.
Well, when the guy was explaining that word right there, he goes, because it's so awful.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. It's
and
so,
those people.
Everything is so bad.
My life is going to be so boring.
No
and
one
I gotta
can
go
spell
to
that for
all
me.
All the time. I could. And, fifth grade spelling bee champion at Soledad Canyon
Go.
Elementary School.
That's not there anymore.
Well, whatever. It's the movie theater
now
in Canyon Country.
That's so funny.
So awfulizing sobriety, right, is that it? You know, we're constantly combating that mental part of our disease that tells us that this life of sobriety is going to be nothing but a veil of tears,
right?
Boring. I'm never
going to have fun.
Oh my God, I'm so young. How can I ever stay sober? And I gotta give. What's the term? I gotta give props.
Yeah.
I don't normally talk like that.
You gotta give credit.
I gotta give credit. I gotta give some props to the young people that stay clean and
absolutely.
Sober. We're in a world today where people are coming in and staying sober at 20 years old, 21 years old, and even some 15, 16 years old, right? Like, that's happening too. And that is amazing to
me. My first introduction to recovery, I was 19. And it was at a treatment center in the Valley, and I thought, oh, yeah, no, this is not for me. And I didn't end up getting sober until my early 30s, you know. But so, yes, I absolutely give props or credit or whatever they deserve to them.
That's
because
Kudos.
Yeah, because it's – and this time – like, marijuana wasn't legal when I got sober.
So here's the.
But in this time, for them to still be getting sober so young, when it's whatever, okay.
Let me preface this by saying Bob's not going to get high.
Bob's not
going to get high. But I am like, there's a part of me, here's my mental obsession, right? There's a part of me that's like, damn.
Talk about mental
relapse.
It's good
and it's legal and it's, right?
Talk about the mental aspect. There it is. Right there.
Because I stopped smoking weed 20 years ago when it wasn't like it is today, right? But that's the mental part of it.
Right.
Is even, you know, I've been sober 14 years, and after 14 years, I smell weed and there's a part of my brain that goes, oh, don't you miss that?
That's the mental, and it catches you off guard too, because it's not something you would normally think. And I try to explain to people, it doesn't mean you're going to go drink or pick up or use, but it's there.
You have to acknowledge it.
And it's there, and like
that's why a practice of mindfulness is so important for us, to sit and meditate and just pay attention to what's going on in your world. Because if I'm doing that all the time, then I can see my brain doing that.
Yeah, and if you're sharing it with someone, I tell people all the time, share with somebody. I mean, I understand a lot of people don't do 12-step, and I'm not going to push 12-step.
Well, cool. Call it a mentor. Friend.
But
call it
somebody. Yeah. Talk to somebody.
And especially somebody who understands
addiction. Yeah.
You know, we teach this in our family groups, and I'm not, you know, going to get into a big explanation of it, but it is the last person in the world that you want to be sharing
is your immediate family.
Your internal struggles with are the people that are emotionally attached
to
you, because they cannot be objective. If I call my mom today and I say, oh my God, Mom, I've had a heck of a week and I really would like to go do some speed right now.
Right.
My mom would be on high alert. She'd call all my friends. Probably not. She knows well
I know what you mean.
Joke
yeah.
around, but she'd call all my family. She'd go, keep an eye on Bob. Everybody reach out. Make sure he's okay.
Right.
If I call my sponsor or somebody else that's in the program that understands addiction, and I said exactly that same thing, they'd say,
get a different reaction.
Oh, me too. Let's go have a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And like, that's why we give that advice, because, you know, the wife or the husband sitting in the room going, I'll help you in any way I can. The best way you can help me is let me work a program.
That's important for the families to understand that as well, is you are too close to the problem. You know, I heard this analogy one time where, you know, I'm in an art museum and I'm standing so close to the picture that I can't see what the picture is.
I love this analogy.
You know?
Yeah.
So, and if you want a good example of that, like, stand up and put your face against a picture on the wall. You can't see anything but the blur that's sitting right in front of you.
Yeah.
And if you stand there long enough, that becomes everything, right? And so you got to take a step back. You have got to take a step back. And because you're too close.
Yeah.
And that's hard for families to do, because they want so bad
especially
to be the one.
Parents.
Yeah, I want to be the one that helps my kid, man.
Yeah, and it's difficult to leave that
to
somebody
go.
Else. Yeah, it's hard, especially when you don't know what's going on. That's why part of our program is, like, for you to come in and teach about addiction in the brain, so that the people who don't understand addiction get a glimpse into what that might be like for their loved one. That's one of the things I love about The Way Out. You know, our connection to the families, but also the realistic views that we give them. Like, you can understand, like, you do this whole thing about, you know, when you're hungry, if you're too hungry. And so I've had people tell me, like, oh, I get that. Like, they can relate because you give them this vision of what it would feel like on a level they could understand. And that's part of what we offer there. And I love that, because not everyone understands the disease of addiction. Not everyone who gets the education on addiction understands the disease of addiction.
Well, we have hear it over and over again.
Yeah, and so I mean, but that struggle with the mental, you have to be able to combat that with something. You have to be able to go, wait, no, it was that bad. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't that bad, you know?
So you've talked about a couple of tools that are really important for when I catch myself, you know, after I've had the education and I understand that that's part of the disease, that my brain is going to try to make recovery into some boring thing that I have to do for the rest of my life.
Right.
And, oh my God, right? And you talked about a couple of tools, you know, voicing that out loud, understanding and being educated on paying attention to that brain and understanding that you don't, that it's okay to have those thoughts.
It's normal to have those thoughts. And the thing is your disease, our disease, wants to isolate us from everybody.
So you're about to get into, so what steps do we take to learn that sobriety is not like that?
You have to participate. Yeah. You have to participate in the recovery process. I mean, even when I did get involved, it wasn't so much I thought it was boring or like my life was ruined, but it was the idea of like never. So I had to take that thought away and just participate in what was going on. Everything that was suggested of me, I did. Go to that meeting. I didn't go, why? Why that meeting? I just went. Get a sponsor. Okay, I'll get a sponsor. You know, there's a convention coming up. So other sober people are going to be there. Go to that convention.
Yeah, we go to dinner after the meeting.
Yeah.
We go to coffee before.
Go to coffee. Go to breakfast.
We hang out. Yeah.
And some of those people are still the most important people in my life today because we don't even realize that we're building these relationships outside of just what the meeting is.
Right.
You know, but, I mean, I always took suggestion in early recovery. I get a lot of people that are like, I don't want to do that. Oh, I've tried that. And maybe that's true, but if you really just surrender everything and just do what's suggested – I found a life that I wouldn't want to change for anything.
And that goes the same for family members as well. You know, you have to get your people too.
Yeah.
You have to have your team around you too. You have to have your fellowship
too.
There's
a whole community.
You have to have your community as well. And a lot of times those communities blend into each other.
Yeah.
There are a lot of activities. We do them at the way, like yesterday.
Yeah,
there was
I had
a potluck,
a whole alumni,
game day,
yeah.
at our site where a lot of people showed up, family members and recovering people.
And you know what? We laughed. Because I had some...
How can you laugh?
We were sober.
How can you laugh in
so
without drugs and
I
alcohol?
Had someone tell me before the alumni potluck, they said, I don't know if I want to come because I don't do board games. I said, well, just come eat. You don't have to play the board games. Okay, I said, we laugh. I don't really laugh. That person.
Oh, I'm laughing.
Let me tell you.
I'm laughing at that statement,
right.
But God, that hurts.
I know.
Right? Because I remember those days
that
when there's nothing
showed up
funny.
Early.
There's
that
nothing funny.
There's nothing funny. Nothing's amusing.
Anymore.
That person showed up early, set up tables with me.
Right.
I didn't even ask them to. They came, they brought food, they sat and played board games, and they laughed the whole entire time.
Right.
So much so they invited their family to come after they checked it out.
Yeah.
And they came.
Oh,
and
they called and said, oh, it's
come
okay.
Down
I
here.
Put my
it's
foot
safe.
In the water. It's cool.
Safe. Yeah.
Come on.
The water's warm.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And so I was like, wow. And this is and that's just how it works.
So what's neat about that experience is that person who's currently in our program can now have the conversation in a group of what was the difference between what your brain was telling you this
exactly.
experience was going to be versus
what
the actual experience was,
right?
And when we learn that, we go, oh my gosh, how many times does that happen?
Right.
How many times do I get up and I
prejudge
I
a situation?
Psych myself out.
Yeah.
And it's not even true.
And here's one of the biggest things I hear, and I'm a culprit. I did this too in recovery, but I had to learn to get rid of that thought is, you know, but I have my own family, and I've been gone for so long in my addiction that I neglected my own family, so I really can't participate in the stuff you're asking me to participate in because I have to be home with my wife and my kids. And, you know, when we're in our addiction, we're not there anyway.
Right.
And so now people feel guilty, and I understand that. And so every second they have, they want to be with their family. But you're not going to be able to maintain sobriety and be there for your family if you're participating in the recovery process.
And
that's
there has to be
really
a sufficient
hard.
Substitute.
Yeah.
There has to be a sufficient substitute from the conviviality of – because, you know, drugs and alcohol, there's a big social aspect
there.
There
is a huge
social aspect. And for a lot of us, we've been doing them so long that it becomes necessary for me to have them to function, to interact with people, my family, whatever. I take that away, and I'm left in this sort of vacuum.
Yeah.
With, I don't even know how to have a conversation. Yeah. And so maybe I want to spend time with my family because I feel like I need to make up for that. But then I sit at home and I'm on edge.
Yeah.
And I'm irritable and I don't know what to say. And
yeah.
I psych myself out.
And then relapse happens.
And then I can relapse, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And I think it's great that people want to spend time with their family. And that's the whole point of recovery, so that you could build relationships and rebuild relationships. Yeah. But you're not going to be able to maintain that by just diving into your family. It's just not going to happen. Maybe for a short while.
Yeah, maybe balance is the word I'm looking for, right?
Balance, absolutely. Because that's part of how relapse happens. You know, you're sitting in your own head at home and you're not doing anything about what you're thinking. And you're present, but you're not really present. You know, with your family. And so, like, that's a big one. Like, oh, well, you know, I'm going to be with my family. And I think that's great. But make time for the other things that we're suggesting. Because if I wasn't doing the things suggested of me, I wouldn't be sober, no matter how much I love my family.
Right.
So, I mean, that's a big thing. That's a key component. And if you're not doing something outside of your family or even outside of treatment, then when those thoughts come, you're not going to be able to fight them off. You know, if I wasn't so involved in a program, and I believe you too, if you weren't so involved in a program at the time where you had that thought that that joint might be nice or that drink might be nice, you probably would have done it because you don't know any different. You're not doing a program. You're not doing anything else fun. You don't have friends, you know? So if we're not doing something that heightens, you know, our, like for me, if I didn't have a whole community of sober people, maybe I wouldn't enjoy sobriety. I don't know. But all my friends are sober. Everybody I associate with is sober. My family, you know, my husband is sober. And, like, that's my community. If I got loaded today, I would lose everything, you know? And so if I'm not involved in that, I have nothing to lose.
It would be hard to hide it.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. I think no one knew for a while.
It would be hard to hide it.
That's my disease.
When your whole world is recovering.
Well, yeah, and so I'm accountable. Yeah. I'm accountable to not only my own family, but my employer, my friends.
I think there's some real security in living a transparent life like that. Where you know, like you and I will have conversations with each other, mm-hmm. and sometimes in public we'll be having these conversations about whatever, and then all of a sudden we'll realize we'll go like, oh my god,
yeah.
like, oh, we're talking out loud about that stuff, and most people don't understand.
And we're
like,
in Walmart.
They're like, oh my god, and we're just openly talking about crack smoking or something, right? And people are shocked by that, but there's a security in that.
When I'm
open about my life,
mm-hmm.
right? That if I relapsed, I couldn't. There's no way I could hide that.
Right.
Because
people
know me too well.
That's all back to the relapse part of it. Because if I'm not connected to anything,
it's easier.
I'm not accountable to anybody else.
Yeah.
I haven't created a whole new community. So, like, if I relapse, I mean, as bad as that would be, I relapse. But if I'm in a community like we were just talking about, it's hard because you really have to think about it. Like, I really have to think about what my world entails in sobriety, and it's everything to me. It wouldn't just be disappointing my daughter and husband. There's a whole world of people that my actions affect. And so for me, being connected keeps me from relapsing. Not that I'm thinking about using, but if I do, I have to think about everything else that's affected by that. And that's part of that story that you told and part of the story I told you. You know, yeah, your mind goes, oh, that would be so much fun. But I have enough recovery in me to go, oh, wait, yeah, no, I'm not that girl dancing. I'm that one throwing up or fighting or whatever.
Yeah.
And I have enough in me to know that if it was that good, I wouldn't have ever got sober. I would still be out there if it was that good. But when I
that's an important and powerful statement, because most people who come into the recovery process, they've hit some sort of a bottom, right? And it's safe to say that probably 100%, maybe every once in a while there might be an anomaly, that come into the recovery process. This is not the first time that you've gotten in trouble. And you've probably been trying to manage and control and keep it together for however long you've been doing that. And if you can stay close enough to that experience, then I don't start to glorify. You know, that's the other part about the mental obsession with it, right? Is that my brain will always try to make it seem like to glorify that life. And so one of the most powerful things that I found to combat that right there is I love going to, they don't necessarily have to be 12-step meetings or AA or NA or whatever, but all kinds of recovery meetings. What I love, especially speaker meetings, what I love about going to meetings is that if I'm there and I'm off my phone and I'm paying attention to what's right. going on in the meeting, I have share after share after share after share of constant reminders
right.
of what the truth of my using looks like. If I'm paying attention and somebody says, I don't know, whatever, like I drove drunk, I told myself I would never drive drunk
right.
with my kids in the car.
Right.
And then I did.
Right.
And I hear that and I go, oh my God, me too.
Yeah.
You know, and it reminds me every time I'm at one of those. So
yeah.
I try to go, you know, I've been at a meeting every day this last yeah. week. I try to go all the time, right? Because I love to hear that because it keeps me in two different things. And maybe we talk about this for a second because we got a couple of minutes left. It reminds me of the truth of what it used to be.
Of how bad it was.
But it also gives me this contrast in the way that my life used to be
right.
versus the way that my life is now. And so I can have a clear picture of, you know, if I'm struggling financially or I'm struggling emotionally or with relationships in my sober life, mm-hmm. it'll never be as bad as it used to be.
Right.
And I get that gratitude.
Oh, and I think some of us, myself included, I forget how I was living. You know, because I can so easily go, it wasn't that bad. Because that's a big part, the last part of the mental is bargaining with yourself and lying to yourself and others. And that's a big part of it, you know. Oh, it wasn't that bad. Well, I'm sorry, I was homeless.
Right.
There was a point in time, you know, so many different things. And I look now and I go, oh, my God, how did I live like that? You know, and it's because I was drinking and using. Because in sobriety, I mean, material things are not important. However, I have accomplished things that have given me the ability to do, you know, to have a home.
I would never be able to have that stuff if I was still using.
I couldn't even have a relationship.
Okay, so here we go for Thanksgiving. So here we go for Thanksgiving week. And it might be hard to pinpoint. Give me the thing that you're most grateful for in sobriety for a happy Thanksgiving.
Ooh.
What are you most grateful for in your life right now?
Relationships.
Yeah.
It's not hard to pinpoint. It's my relationships.
Yeah. I got to say this because my two boys are sitting out there. And and you know how much they mean to me. Mm-hmm. And you know that if you were to ask me that question, I'm going to say bar none, Jack and Dean Sherritz mm-hmm. are absolutely the thing that I am the most grateful for. And I love them without a shadow of a doubt.
Mm-hmm.
And I got to say that in sobriety, I've been able to be a pretty good dad.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so let me say this to you. I love you.
I love you too.
I know your family, and you are the absolute best wife to Richard and the best mom to Ronnie that you could ever, ever be.
Oh,
and I'm grateful to see you as
live.
An example. She's all, don't make me cry.
We are live.
I love you, Melissa. Thanks for coming on the show.
I love you so much.
Stay grateful this week, folks, and hug your loved ones. If you don't have a turkey dinner to go to, there are lots of places that you can.
There are meetings. Meetings all over the holidays.
The Way Out Recovery Hour. We'll see you next week.